Good morning. Good morning. Why does everybody stand up? People can start making their way in from the foyer. I just wanted to get started. My spirit, like that prayer room today. Woo! As we've just entered into this season of rest, I feel like the rest that he has been giving has not been this like, just lay back. I know you're exhausted. Let me just wash you. And like there's this rest month compared to December rest month is like new life. Not like resting for the night, but it's like... There's such joy on it. There's such newness on it. It's about stepping into new, not breaking in between. And this morning, I was just prophesying over two people, and it was, as I was saying it, I could just feel the Lord saying it's not just for them. It's starting with them. But him just saying, choose my weight. If you're going to carry weight, choose my weight. Choose my glory. And I just see an exchange this morning. I see an exchange where he's saying, I'll take your weight. All you have to do is take mine. You don't have to figure out anything. Just choose my weight. So I just want you to put your hands out this morning and hand over yours and choose his. Yay. Choose his weight. Yeah. And I just declare new life in this weight. His new life in this weight. The week after we celebrate his resurrection, his blood still speaks a better word. His blood is just beginning to flow in the new life. Yay. So we just step into this weight. Yay. We step into this weight. We step into your weight. We step into your weight. And we do it right now because praise and worship is a response. It's a response, and so we're choosing what we're responding to right now. We are choosing to respond to your weight, to your glory, to your goodness, to your blood that speaks a better word. Wow. So just receive his weight. Receive his weight. Receive his weight. Receive his weight. And you might find that his weight feels more like bubbles. Or vibrating. Whoa. Or when you have too much caffeine. That's kind of what I'm feeling in my body right now. So step into his weight. Yay. Step into his new life as we start this month with our focus solely on him. Ooh. I just want you to lift your voices right now before we start. Just lift your voices in this way. Begin to activate. Begin to activate. Put your belief behind what he is saying. Begin to respond. Begin to respond. This is how we worship unified. It's not them leading us in a performance. It's us joining together. So let's decide that we're going to lead them. Let us lead. Let us pick up the weight. Let us begin to respond. And so we respond. You're good. You're good. You're good. You're good. You're good. I put all of my attention on you. On you. Woo! respond. Wow, we respond. Thank you, Lord.
Spirit was moving over the water. Spirit, come move. Trusting God, never fail me. You stick closer than a brother. You never fail me, Jesus. That's why I trust you. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord. Come on. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord.
Yeah.
That's why I trust you. That's why I trust in you. Sing it if you don't believe it. And that's why I trust you. And that's why I trust in you. And that's why I trust in you. Come on, sometimes I have to sing it when I don't believe it. Yeah. That's why I trust in you. Cause that's why you'll never let me down, Jesus. That's why I trust in you. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who never fails. He will never fail. Oh, you never fail.
I trust in
Burn forever like this. You're all I want.
Grateful. Just keep on telling him. Thank him. Tell him how grateful you are. Lift up your hands. Lift up your faces. Lift up your voices and tell him that we're thankful, Lord. Okay. No, that's good. Let's keep worshiping. Amen. Let's go back in. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Just stay in that place. Keep your eyes and focus on Him. Oh, thank you, Lord.
And I will give you all.
Stop here this morning, but it continues. Every little glance towards you, Lord Father, every time we acknowledge you, every time that we fall on our knees or pray or read your word, we're acknowledging that you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and that we indeed love you. You are our only hope and our only salvation, and you fill us with hope and goodness, and you encourage us and you nurture us, and your wings are around us. You hold us close when we need it. You throw us out of the nest when we need it. You're a God of promises. I want to read out the scripture. It's an oldie, but a goodie. Jeremiah 29, but I'm going to start in 10. Because he's talking to the Israelites. This is what the Lord says. When 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will come to you and fulfill my good promise to bring you back to this place. So focus on promise, the word promise. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. Lord, receive our seeking this morning. Receive our hearts with praise for you. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back from captivity. I wanted you to focus on that word promise, because the Lord has given us all promises. And sometimes we feel that some of those promises are in captivity. But we can come before the Lord. He can remind us of the promises that He has given us that we have sometimes forgotten or let go. So I just wanted to take a moment and ask the Lord, is there a promise, Lord? Is there a promise, Father, that you gave me that I have forgotten or I've let go? So take a time to listen. See if there's something that was deep in your heart. And ask the Lord to breathe life on it again. It is not too late. No matter how long ago that was or how impossible that may seem, He is the God of promises. And you give it back to Him. And you say, Lord, breathe life on that promise. So, Father, we pray that right now, Lord Jesus, for those who just had something come up that was like, wow, that was something I had years ago. And I've given up hope. Or I think it's impossible. Or I've maybe missed it. I've done something wrong. Father, would you show them that you have not forgotten, that you are faithful and you breathe life on long forgotten promises. In Jesus' name, we love you, Lord. Thank you, worship team. Amen, amen. Okay, we've got kids been released over there somewhere with the exit sign. Say hello to a neighbor.
Good morning, everyone. How are you today? Welcome, welcome, welcome to the gate. This is my lovely wife, Carla. Actually, you're starting, aren't you?
I am. You got Mike happy there. Good morning. So this is Jonathan, and I'm Carla. Good morning. A few quick announcements before we dive in. This month, we are already in April, is Rest Month. If you have not been with us for that long, we take intentional time to take a month of rest where we kind of clear the calendar of all the activities and focus on resting in the presence. And so how we do that is instead of our normal weekly labs and prayer nights and Friday night services, we're doing soaking nights here in the sanctuary on Friday nights from 7 to 8:30 p.m. And soaking is just a beautiful way to connect with the presence of God in a peaceful and intentional atmosphere. So if you've never been, I invite you to come out this Friday night and for the remaining Friday nights of April. With that in mind, because most things have been canceled, one thing has not, and that is youth group meetings. because they don't need rest, right? You know, they don't need time. I think they need more things. Yeah, the parents can rest, exactly, while the youth comes on Wednesday nights from 7 to 9 p.m. So youth, Wednesdays, soaking Fridays. Got it? Second thing, we have our garden tea. And this sounds so much fun. So ladies, men, tune out. Women, focus. April 27th, mark your calendars. This is going to be an exciting garden tea here at the church from 1:30 to 4 p.m. I love how it says in the afternoon, as if we were going to show up at 1:30 in the morning to this just garden tea. Just to clarify, it's in the afternoon, okay? Oh, just kidding. It is in Waxhaw. That is not on here, but that is an important detail. So in Waxhaw, I'm sure this is in the newsletter, but just a little preview. This is an event open to women of all ages. So bring your little ones. I'm excited to bring my little girl. And it's going to be a time spent with one another on a lawn. You're right. It's not specific. It says a lawn. Enjoying tea and treats as well as croquet tournament. So dresses are required, okay? Hats, welcomed. And if you feel adventurous, you may even wear an 1800s costume. Who's a costume freak? I am. Okay. So registration is almost full. So please connect with the newsletter. There's going to be a QR code here at the end, and you want to make sure that you get registered for that.
All right. How's your croquet game?
It's awesome.
Is it strong? Yeah. She's got a strong croquet game. So come ready. All right. We've got labs. Not in April, though, right? Okay. May. It was right there. All right. So in May, we are going to have labs. Stephen Cozine is going to be leading. What? Big Papa back there, both literally, and he's also going to be leading our Experiencing the Father's Embrace lab. So this is a book by Jack Frost. We've had Jack's wife, Trisha Frost, ministering in this house even just recently. So you guys remember Trisha from a few weeks ago? So Stephen's going to be leading the May lab. It's on Wednesday nights from 7 p.m. to 9 p.m. And Experiencing the Father's Embrace shows you how you can personally feel your Father's loving and comfort embrace and points out the areas that may be hindering you from experiencing a more intimate relationship with your Creator. Does that not sound awesome? Yeah, so Stephen, thank you for that. That's coming up in May, Wednesday night, 7 to 9. And then we also have our church picnic on May 5th. Oh, a little Cinco de Mayo picnic. Look who's back there. All right, Cinco de Mayo picnic. We've got that coming up. Cinco de Mayo. There we go. All right, this one is happening on the front lawn. Is this one?
Yeah.
This one's front lawn. All right. So food trucks, outdoor activities, bouncy houses for the kids. Oh, they have to specify that because I've been known to jump in some bouncy houses. So cornhole tournament. Find a partner and register your team for the cornhole tournament soon. And we would love to see you all there. That's one of our favorite events. We love that one. So make sure you guys make it out on Cinco de Mayo. And you can find all this and more on our newsletter. So make sure you check out the QR code and get signed up. Welcome, John. Let's give him a hand.
Thank you, guys. They're hard to follow. Yeah. They're hard to follow, like a whole thing. Yeah, totally. Was that worship just like amazing or what? I was like, just felt like I could have just floated in that river all day long. It was just so good. Wow. I don't know if you know that. I mean, we put it online, but if you don't know, Lee up here, that is the son of Randall and Penny. So Lee Worley is here with us today, and he was leading worship. So, well, this morning I get to take up the offering. And I love how this church celebrates Jesus so much. I always tell people it's their first time speaking, they're like nervous. I said, really, you can't blow it. I mean, just get up and talk about Jesus, and you're going to get so celebrated. But this morning, I'm going to take up the offering, and I was thinking about it. I talked a lot last week on, we had just a great time at Easter last week, didn't we? And we talked about, you know, how Jesus came and he didn't just come to save the earth. He came to restore people. If his only purpose was salvation, he would have died and rose and been out of here. But he needed to hang around and heal the hearts of his friends. And I was thinking about Peter. And isn't it interesting that the two different times that Jesus chose to reveal himself, he chose to reveal himself to Peter when he was fishing. And the first time that Jesus revealed himself to Peter was really an offering. It said that, I'm just going to read it. I've read this many times, but I love this passage. Luke 5:1 says that one day as Jesus was standing by the lake, people were crowding around him and listening to the word of God. And he saw the waters... He saw the water's edge, two boats left there by the fishermen who were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put it out a little bit from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the people from the boat. Such a beautiful picture, honestly, of him giving of a resource for the gospel to be preached. It's basically an offering. And it says that when he'd finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put back out into the deep water and let down your nets for the catch." And Simon answered, "Master, we've worked hard all night and haven't caught anything, but because you say so." Isn't it amazing that Jesus will accept obedience even when there's no faith? There's no faith here in this answer, but he said, "I'll be obedient. You told me to." And it said when they'd done so, they caught such a large number of fish that their nets began to break. So they signaled to their partners in the other boats to come and to help them. And they came and filled both the boats so full that they began to sink. And as the scripture goes on and talks about from there, they come back on shore and he realizes who Jesus is. And he says, "I'm going to follow you." And he says, "No longer will you be you'll now be a fisher of men." It's such a powerful moment and such a powerful picture of Jesus. He often would reveal himself in places of giving, wouldn't he? I mean, you think about the lady that poured the perfume on his feet. And there was, you know, such a powerful revelation that she was welcomed into just out of a place of giving. And so I think when we give to the Lord, it truly is, one, supposed to be a joyful time. And two, I think that's an invitation of something greater than what we may see in an offering. It's actually an invitation to have a greater revelation of who he is. And so this morning, as we give, can we just receive from the Lord whatever. I feel like he wants to reveal some things to us this morning. So just put your hand on your heart for a moment. And Father, we just come before you with grateful hearts this morning. And if we don't feel like there's gratitude, I ask that you would just right now, even in this moment, even in the offering, let that joy of the Lord just begin to bubble up in the hearts all over this room. That, Father, that we would be filled with your joy. We would be filled, Father, with gratitude as we give to you. And in that place, Father, we ask, Lord, that we would once again encounter just a greater revelation of who you are and your love for us. What a great spot to really have an encounter with the Lord in an offering. It's so great of a place to be in, of giving unto the Lord. So, Father, we give to you freely. Freely we've received, freely we give. We love you, we honor you, in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Ushers, you can come on up and pass the baskets. And well, I'm super excited about this morning. I'm going to go through a couple things before I welcome up Randall. Just wanted to let you know, Tiffany and I are doing something fun. We're actually going to be leaving this week, and we're going to Europe for a while. And I hope you're celebrating for us instead of celebrating us leaving. We're really excited about it. We get to go. We're going to be 1 week from today. We'll be preaching at a church in London. And we're going to be in London. Then we get to take a train, and we're going to go up to Scotland. And I get to be with people that look like me for a little while. And so if, like, we're real excited about staying. How about this? We're going to be staying in a castle. Our friends Bill and Tracy are holding an event and called Kingmakers, and we're going to be going out and joining them for that. And just and then it's also our celebration for Tiffany and our 20-year anniversary. So we're excited about that. And while we're gone, you guys are going to have a glorious time. You're going to have some fun. I know that AJ's preaching 1 week, and I know that Mikey's going to be preaching his first time while we're gone. So we're really excited about... See, you get celebrated for everything. Isn't it great? Really excited about it. And so we will be back and look forward. Every time we go, it feels like just amazing things happen. Well, this morning, One of my favorite folks is going to be speaking, and one of the jokes we always have around here with the photography team is see if you can catch a picture of Randall smiling while he's preaching. And we have finally figured out what it takes for smiles. You got it? You got it in the back, Andy? Oh, maybe. You're leaving me hanging. Didn't work. So we have a picture. We have a picture of Randall. You're not going to see it on my phone, but him with all of his family and all of his grandkids sitting in the middle with the greatest smile ever. And I was going to show it to you this morning, but it didn't work. And so we are, Randall and Penny both are super dear to us. We went to a retreat. Many of you don't know this, but, oh boy. Hope there's nothing weird on the TV. Oh, there it is. There it is. That's how we get a smile. That is a smile. He's smiling. You just can't tell. There it is. It's a big girl. There it is. Super zoom. Thanks. I love Andy. He can make anything happen. But we were at a pastor's retreat back in October of 2022, actually right before things really broke open, a couple weeks later at the gate. And I really feel like it was a part of why things took off the way they did. It was the first time I'd actually met Lee. And I don't even know if Lee's in here right now, but there he is. He made the strongest cup of coffee I've ever had in my life. What'd you call that thing? A red eye? Yeah. It was espresso shots in coffee. If you want to wake up and really wake up, let him make you a cup of coffee. And we went to this event where they basically just took a group of pastors, put them into a beautiful condo for a week on the water, and said, you're not allowed to do anything. If you've ever seen people wiggle, it's to put a group of pastors in a room and say, you're not allowed to do anything. You're not allowed to take your plate to the trash can. You're not allowed to pick up. You're not allowed to make your plate of food. Like, you are going to be taken care of all week. And they have such a grace for ministering to pastors. And I say that to say this, because they've really been more than just, some people are guest speakers, some people are so much more than that. And Randall and Penny are so much more than just a guest speaker this morning. They're people that have poured into us. And a lot of what you experience, and you come to us and say, we love the gate, we love the culture of the gate, there's people that pour into us that we get to pour back out. And so this morning, as Randall comes to minister, I'd really like to honor him this morning. So can we welcome up Randall this morning as he ministers?
You won't believe what he just whispered in my ear. He said, take your time. Yeah, we do always look forward to coming here. And this is really one of the few places that I'm invited to that when my wife hears about it, she is on board. She doesn't get to travel with me as much as we would like. And John and Tiffany, they do hold a very dear place in our hearts, have for a long, long time. And we love you guys. There's nothing you can do about it. We're not easy to get rid of. Even though you do scorn me for not smiling as much as you would prefer. All right, stop it. It really is a bonus for my wife and I, too, to have our son with us here this morning. We don't get to do this very often. He grew up. He started out on our worship team as a drummer, and we had a sense back then that he was going to be doing more, and now he leads worship at the great Seacoast Church in Mount Pleasant, and we just, you know how it is, Papa Matthews, when you start talking about your kids and your grandkids. We become incorrigible, don't we? Yeah, we really do. I want to invite you to turn to a very familiar text. It's found in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 11, and the words that we're about to read are probably some of the best-known words of Jesus, and in some ways probably the most misunderstood, as far as I'm concerned, and even misapplied. And I'll explain what I mean by that in just a few moments. But before we get there, I understand that you are right now with great intention in a time where you are resting or you are resetting to rest. That's really what I want to talk about, a reset to rest. And I assure you that probably some of the things that I'll be saying in regard to rest might be somewhat challenging to you. Why change my reputation? I'll never forget many years ago, before we get into the text, many years ago, I was at a conference, it's probably 30, 35 years ago, with someone that a few of you may recognize his name. His name is Tommy Barnett, who led the great First Assembly in Phoenix. It was a mega church at the time, 8,000-10,000 people. It went on to become known as the Dream Center there, as well as in Los Angeles. And just to be honest with you, when I first saw Tommy Barnett, get up on the platform, just within minutes, I was exhausted just watching this guy. I mean, it was like he ran on jet fuel. You know personalities like that. I mean, there's so much energy. And so he's talking to several thousand pastors in this conference, and he's actually talking about rest. And because he was a very sought-after conference speaker, he had been called out to, I believe, New York or somewhere in the Northeast to speak at this conference. And while he was there, he received news that one of the beloved charter members of his church had passed away. And so he had not completed his assignment at the conference, and explained that he needed to fly home, do the funeral, and that he would fly back. And so he does that. He gets on the plane, he flies to Phoenix, he gets there just in time to walk out on the platform and do the eulogy. He's still thinking in the back of his mind that he's got to get this done and get back to the airport to get back to New York. So he does the eulogy, and remember I described his personality, his frenetic way. He does the eulogy, he goes out to get in the car to follow the hearse and the family car to the gravesite. And he said as he was following them in the procession, he forgot for a moment what he was doing and where he was at, and actually began to think, why are these people driving so slow? And he pulled out to pass the hearse and the family car, and it wasn't until he saw the looks on the faces of the family that he became present again. And he told that story, a true story, to try to relate to us how that we are restless, how that we don't know or understand the nature of rest. So in Matthew chapter 11, beginning with, let's start with verse 25. At that time, Jesus declared, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things from the wise and understanding and revealed them to the little children. Yes, Father, for such as your gracious will, all things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father. And no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal himself. Now, these words that he's just spoken are a segue into a text that, as I've already mentioned, that most of us are very familiar with, but probably more than likely we have not completely understood and certainly misapplied. You will recognize these next words. Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Jesus certainly knew his audience and knew them well. And I would probably be correct if I were to suggest to you that most of you have heard this text referenced quite often when extending the invitation for someone to accept Jesus, someone who has yet to embrace the faith. The thing that is problematic about that is Jesus was not talking to unbelievers. He was talking to those who were already followers. They were already believers, and he recognized something that I think he still recognizes in most of us, that the practicing of our faith has become so demanding, or we've allowed it to be such, and it has become draining. Now, I have an affinity for the Message translation, Eugene Peterson's translation of this, because I think it puts things really into context. Listen to the way Peterson translates this. "Are you tired, worn out, burned out on religion? Come to me and get away with me and you'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me, work with me. Watch how I do it. Learn," and this is the phrase that I really like, "learn the unforced rhythms of grace." Everybody say that. The unforced rhythms of grace. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. "I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company with me, and you'll learn to live freely and lightly." Again, I like the phrase, the rhythms of grace. And I know that I may be taking somewhat of a license or liberty here with this next statement, but I think the algorithms of our culture have hijacked the rhythms of grace, hijacked us from the rhythms of grace. Well, we most of the time live unconscious to the fact that we live in a certain rhythm. Rhythm, you know, even those of you that are rhythmically challenged, and I don't want to look around and identify anybody in particular. I've seen a few here this morning. But you all, without even being conscious of it, live in a certain rhythm. When you came in this morning, after a few bars into the first song, the rhythm of that particular song began to calibrate the rhythm of your own heart. It not only affected the rhythm of your heart, but the rhythm of your brain waves. That's one of the things about worship that I think that we need to be reminded of, that there's something at a deeper, even more psychic level that is happening to us, that is happening even at a cellular level. But the culture that we live in lives at the speed of swipe. Rest is really, as Jesus is talking about it here, is somewhat foreign. And as I will share with you today, that rest that Jesus is talking about is not inactivity, but directed activity. And there's a great difference between inactivity and directed activity. I think every one of us need to be reminded that we rest in God, not in outcomes. We don't rest in outcomes, we rest in God. If you are resting in outcomes, that's the reason why you remain restless. Recently, and I won't divulge the person's identity, But recently there was a leader, a dear friend of mine that I've come to know over the years, that announced that he was stepping down from his role as a leader for a season. I contacted him. I've talked to him since, and I told him, I said, you know, your vulnerability and transparency was one of the most inspiring things that I've seen in a long time. You know, I believe that his admission that he was not bulletproof or able to leap tall buildings with a single bound was a revelation that, with most of us not knowing when to retreat, is really the leader's kryptonite. And that's not only true of people that are in positions of leadership, because most of us have wrongfully defined the meaning of the word retreat, because it doesn't necessarily mean a regression. It just really means that you're progressing in a different direction. Some of the greatest and most infamous battles that have been lost by bulletproof leaders in history have been lost as a result of them not knowing when to retreat, but always, always advancing. And they avoid the necessity of retreating. They recklessly continue to push forward. I mean, have you ever noticed, when you look at the rhythms that Jesus seemed to live in, that he was never hurried? He would allow no one to hurry him, no matter how pressing they felt their need was. I like what the RSV, you know, we refer to him as the Son of Man. And 80 times he would refer to himself as the Son of Man. He actually preferred being called the Son of Man instead of being called the Son of God. Many of us miss that. But the Revised Standard Version does not refer to him as the Son of Man, but it calls him the Human One. The Human One, which to me implies that Jesus is the quintessential human. He is what humanness looks like. And you will never find him being pressed by anyone or hurried by anyone. Now, I know I'm stating the obvious, but, you know, we think that right now most of us pride ourselves in living in the age of technology, when in reality we're living more in the age of anxiety. And technology, as much as I appreciate its benefits, is exacerbating this even more. This really is the age of anxiety. And anxiety doesn't always have to have an object, does it? Sometimes it's very obscure. It's ambiguous. I was shocked to read recently that an average high school student today has the same level of anxiety that an adult had in the 1950s that was a psychiatric patient. The gravity of negativity, as I would put it, is always pulling us down. It's a force that's like a vortex, isn't it? Which makes the discussion or addressing the topic of rest almost incomprehensible for most people. Anxiety is an interesting word. It's in the same family of words as angina, the constriction of blood vessels, asphyxiation. Anger, it's in the same family of words. Have you sensed, and I'm sure you have, have you sensed that the culture at large is living in a big anger? I don't know how to put it any more clearly. It's the root of it really is anxiety. The root of it really has to do with feeling like we've lost control. That there's nothing that we have any control over any longer. That's why anxiety is asphyxiating nature. How many times in the course of a day Come on, let's be honest. How many times in the course of a day do you find yourself involuntarily doing this? Yeah. Why? I mean, you don't really think to do that, but involuntarily, your body goes, because it's almost as if your body is starved of oxygen. You feel the choking nature of the culture that is constantly trying to hijack the rhythm of rest that Jesus talks about. And I will repeat this again. When Jesus talks about rest, he's not talking about inactivity. He's talking about directed activity. Now more than ever before, you will really find your purpose. You will find your rest in your ability to say no. And not allowing, whether it's an inside job or coming from without, allowing that to guilt you into doing something that you don't have the grace for. See, I've lived long enough to understand this all too well. I wish that I could put this in a syringe and vaccinate you with it. I wish it were that easy. I wish, you know, and I'll tell you as well, I wish that it was as easy as imparting it to you. But this is something that does not come through impartation, and we'll see that in what Jesus is saying. I mean, have you ever wondered why Jesus used this Hebrew idiom, take my yoke upon you? Well, most of us, when we hear the word yoke, we immediately think of something that is a very crude instrument that was used quite often in an agricultural culture of the first century, where you have the picture in your mind, don't you? You have the image in your mind of two brawny oxen, you know, these massive animals. And there's this crude horizontal bar that connects these two oval-shaped, usually made out of leather apparatuses that fit around their neck for the purpose of harnessing their power to plow a field. And I'm sure that that was summoned in the consciousness of those that Jesus said that. He said, take my yoke upon you. But there was something else that they heard, because this was also a euphemism in the culture in which Jesus taught, of someone following a particular teaching. Now, I want you to pay close attention to what I'm about to say, because it's integral to what we're going to be talking about going forward. If you were in yoke with someone in Jesus' time, it meant that you had chosen to follow a certain rabbinical teaching. You had a favorite rabbi. And it would be said of you, in those euphemistic terms, that you were in yoke with them. Unconsciously, not even realizing that much of what you were receiving from them was in many ways controlling your destiny. Jesus said this, didn't he? He said, come to me. Now, usually when I hear people describe their conversion experience, I usually hear it described this way, and I'm not questioning the legitimacy of their description. They say, when I invited Jesus into my life, and they tell me where it happened, how it happened. And in reality, though, this is not really a description of us inviting Jesus into our life, but Jesus inviting us into his. Again, I'm not questioning the legitimacy of your conversion. That's why I've said probably on previous visits here that we have grossly misunderstood the practice of prayer, that prayer is not you informing God. It is for your formation. Prayer has never been about you telling God about your dilemma or your situation, but prayer is God's invitation to you to leave what you consider to be reality and to enter His. Come to me, he says. You that are exhausted, you that are burnt out, you that are doing good things, but you've lost the purpose in it all. It's very easy to lose purpose when we are not in pace with him. He is using this vivid imagery here that if you get in yoke with me, there's certain things that you're going to learn about me and learn about yourself. And unlearning is a very, very difficult process. Am I talking to the right people? I mean, really, I think all genuine learning that has an indelible effect on you is the result of unlearning. I mean, how many times have you said, especially those of you that are a little older, I wished I had learned that 20 years ago. I see your nods of assent. Yeah, it's okay. How many times have I thought that myself? Well, more than likely, I was not ready to learn it. That's why I didn't get it 20 years ago. Maybe it was because I was so ego-driven that I would not have been able to hear it. I would not have been able to receive it. I would not have been able to assimilate it into my learning experience. Jesus, when he's talking about rest here, because I made the distinction here when I was reading it, I hope you heard the emphasis. He first of all talks about rest given, then he talks about rest found. Because rest given to me, of course, speaks of the gratuitous nature of God, that it's not by works, lest any man should boast. It's by grace that you're saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It's not a new effort. You become a new creation. That was one of the most liberating truths that I ever discovered many years ago when I began to see that God never asked me to live for him. He never intended for me to live for him, even though I grew up in a religious culture that emphasized how important it was for us to live for him. And that has maybe somewhat of a shocking effect on some of you at this particular point. But he never intended for you to live for him. It was always his design and desire to live his life in and through you. You attempting to live for him is what has been so exhausting for you. It doesn't exalt him, it exhausts him. If he's capable of being exhausted. That's why Paul, probably one of the most brilliant revelations that he ever had in Galatians 2, when he said, I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. He is acknowledging, it's not even my faith. It's not even my faith. It's his faith. The life that I now live is this marvelous exchange. And understanding, probably one of the greatest revelations that you ever come to is the Christian life is not difficult, it's impossible. Yet religion tends to constantly be reminding us in some manner or some way that we need to be getting our act together. And I assure you that once you do get your act together, it's still nothing but an act. That's all it is. How many times have you said this? I know I have, but I stopped saying a long time ago. God, use me. Maybe you said it as recent as this morning. Sincerely, you said it, God, use me. And I understand what you mean when you say, God, use me. But I stopped praying that way a long time ago because I don't think it's a good way of framing how God relates to us at all. I mean, think about it. Any close relationships that you have with your spouse, your kids, your friends, do you use them? We need a healthier way of talking about this. Wouldn't you agree? Asking God to use us assumes that all God really cares about is getting what he wants done. And are there just people around that I can use to get it done? That's the reason why a lot of people, you know, again, I don't think people give up on God as quickly as they give up on themselves. I mean, if you look around on any given Sunday and you see someone who is glaringly missing that was a fixture, don't come to the wrong conclusions. Assumption is the lowest form of knowledge. It has no witness or evidence whatsoever. But you assume that that individual is absent without leave because they gave up on God. And the truth of the matter is they probably gave up on themselves. And the reason why they gave up on themselves is because they did not come to Jesus. They thought they had come to Jesus, but they came to a wrong representation of him. They came to someone that they thought had unrealistic expectations of them. I mean, I know who I'm talking to here this morning, and there are many of you that have experienced spiritual abuse from leaders that were only interested in using you to accomplish their vision. And it's very easy for us as a result to project that image onto God. People are not God's project. There's your smile. Did you get a picture of that? God's project is bringing people into abundant life, into the rhythms of his grace, into the rhythms of his rest, to know that he's not expecting anything from you. That's why I think it's so profoundly simple, but to me simply profound, that Jesus receives the affirmation of his Father before he's ever taught one thing or performed one miracle or even gone through the wilderness temptation. He's not done anything. And this is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. I thought that was more powerful than your response. It'd be so counter to his nature completely for him to degrade us by using us in the pursuit of some project. I'm still talking about the rest of God. Notice he says here that he is gentle and lowly of heart. Some translations, he says, I'm humble. And that sounds almost pretentious, doesn't it, to say I'm humble? Maybe it's because we've not clearly understood the essence of humility. Because humility is in the same family of words as human, humor, humus. You know what humus is, don't you? Any of you have a compost garden? Do you? You have a compost place, you know, where you take things that have once lived and now they're decaying and you let them complete the process of decay because the transformation that takes place in that compost will give life to something else later on. This is all wrapped up in what Jesus is talking about here. And really what he is striking at the very heart of is control. Because remember, he says, take my yoke upon you. Learn to walk with me in the rhythms that have been, notice the verses that I read to you before. He said, everything that I have been given to has been given to me has been given by the Father. Whatever I know is because the Father has revealed it to me. And what I know about myself is because of my relationship with the Father. The problem with many of us is that we allow ourselves to be impressed by those who are impressed with us. And Jesus did not believe his own press. So he is really, whether we realize it or not, he is dealing with the issue of control. And control really does carry a dual meaning. One has a negative connotation and the other is positive. I mean, let's look at the negative first. You already know this. You're a smart bunch. The negative manifests itself in our lives when we attempt to get people to do what we think is best in any given situation. Now, you take notes on this. It would be helpful for some of those people in your life that you deal with every day that have these propensities. And you know as well as I do, it can be subtle and it can be covert as well. Overt, subtle. It can be either one. I mean, have you ever said something to someone and in mid-sentence your conscience convicted you to the point that you begin to become so self-aware, was that said with an ulterior motive? When you're feeling that, you're feeling the tug of his yoke. You're beginning to be made more self-aware, and very few people live in self-awareness, me included, of your tendency toward control. Why we do what we do is as important as what we do. There's no question about it. This is what Jesus is talking about. I mean, when we start addressing, if I had time, I would. When we start addressing the topic of control, it's about as painful as a root canal, isn't it? Jesus was confronting this need for control. We're not wired to be humble. Even the person that is the most demure and dismissive and even self-deprecating, which is a really dangerous thing. Can be susceptible to what I'm talking about. The voice of humility does not speak up or shout within you. It doesn't shout out loud. It's just kind of gently. That's why he said, I'm lowly of heart. That's what it does. He said, if you do this, you will find rest for your souls. I'm so glad to hear in our conversations that you guys are doing the soul work. Because you do know that you can have an encounter with God. And the problem with that, after that encounter happens, is as powerful and as legitimate as it is, you forget that wherever you go, you are there. And that every problem you have ever had, you've been present. That there is such an integration. See, this is something that is missing. I could get in real trouble here talking about some of the misconceptions concerning the word deliverance itself. Because seldom is deliverance something that is instantaneous and continuously sustained. You were saved, you are being saved, and you shall be saved. The Bible does talk about the spirit, soul, and body, that you are a spirit that has a soul that lives in a body. But one of the problems with that is that we forget just how integrated they are. And that is not something that should cause us to feel, you know, this feeling of self-loathing. He understands that. In fact, those are some of the things that he loves the most about you. You think he is so much drawn to and gravitates so much to your spirituality, and you forget that he loves the soulish part of you as well. Some of the most powerful encounters, and I won't give you any details because it's really not suitable even for this audience, but some of the most powerful encounters that I have had with God have not been in the context of a church or a worship service, but when I was being a jerk, there were so many words that went across the screen just now. And in that moment, you know, my natural response is to slip off into self-loathing. And I can't tell you how many times I have had him to nudge me. I've felt the yoke pull me in a certain direction. This is a learning moment for you. And I was not surprised by your behavior. And it really doesn't make any difference what you believe about yourself or what you think about yourself, because you never have had a right to have an opinion about yourself. My opinion is the only opinion that has ever mattered about you. You know, maybe I should have pointed out as well, because I believe that, I don't think that it's speculation. I mean, you can look at the context and the culture of Jesus' time. But Jesus was a carpenter, which I don't think just implies that he made furniture. I think he also fashioned yokes. I mean, allow me a little liberty here. Maybe outside of the carpenter shop, it says, we do yokes well. But you do understand, see, this is one of the things that has become so problematic in church culture is that, you know, with good intention, we assume that this is a one-size-fits-all situation. And a farmer, if he had two fine specimens, two oxen, he would not just go and buy a generic one-size-fits-all yoke. He would take his oxen to the carpenter and get measurements. That's the reason why Jesus talked about there. And I mentioned in the Message translation, he said that when you step into the rhythms of my grace, it is not ill-fitting. It's not ill-fitting. Most of the time, the people in your life that are the most exacerbating, they are revealing not the change that needs to take place in them, but the change that needs to take place in you. You ever considered that? Think about the person right now that is frustrating you the most. And this is God. He has you in his yoke. And he is trying his best to help you to see. This is what needs to change in you. Now, as we come to a close, I want to get a little more mystical on you, okay? I think I've been practical enough. The first mention of rest that we have in Scripture happens in the Genesis account, in the cradle of creation. And the Scripture says that on the seventh day, God rested from all of his works. I say this, and I'm sure that it would in some ways stir some up, but I say this without fear of contradiction, that God has already done everything that he's ever going to do. Boy, hear that fall in here like an anvil. What do you mean God has already done it? Yeah, he's already done everything he's ever going to do. All the other days he called good, but the seventh day he didn't call it good, he called it holy. And I love the vivid imagery there. I wish that the writer of Genesis was, you know, elucidated far more, but I love the imagery that is there, that he created man in the sixth day, and when he awakened in the seventh, on the dawn of the seventh day, which means that when he woke up, everything was already finished. I value your pursuit for a revival, but I think there's something that very possibly could transcend our pursuit of revival, which possibly just might be an awakening. Think of it, when Adam woke up, there was nothing to do. It was already done. God, in his infinite genius, did that on purpose, because if he knew, if he'd create him on the fourth or fifth day, that Adam definitely would have tried to help. I love the words of Isaiah that I've been referencing for years and years. See, you start things in order to finish it. God finishes it, then he starts it, because he said he declared the end from the beginning. So how do we enter this rhythm of rest? We don't look for something new or novel or something sensational. We just get into it because, see, there was a river that flowed out of Eden, and it parted, a single river that flowed out of Eden. This is a metaphor that is very strong in your culture. I get it. There was a river that flowed out of Eden, and it parted into three rivers, and it watered the entire planet. The imagery there is not just to give us something of geographic in nature, to help us to understand that he is the one that is the fountainhead of the river, and if we can get into the flow, this is a word that is not just unique to your world or my world as it relates to what we're in pursuit of. This is something that is really the collective consciousness of so many people around the world that are coming into the fullness of their particular destiny of purpose, is that they realize it is not so much about forcing something, but getting into the flow of what is already there. I hope that word consciousness didn't derail you there. It really is an important word. Because I think that more than ever, what God is desiring right now, especially in an age of anxiety, isn't an awakening. Because most of us are sleepwalking. Most of us are walking to the drumbeat of the talking heads and the media, and he's looking for a people that will awaken to something that transcends the consciousness of this age. I mean, over and over again, you see the imagery of this. When God decides that he's going to make, go ahead and stand. When God decides that he is going to make covenant with Abram, who was a pathological liar, I mean, the father of our faith, put in the right situation, he's going to lie. So when he decides that he's going to make covenant with Abram, which prefigures the covenant that was made in Adam, because Adam was already asleep, and then he woke up to something God had already done. And he does the same thing with Abram, knowing his propensity to lying. And Hebrews really makes it clear. He says that God knew, or God could not swear by anybody greater than himself, so he swore by himself. And he put Abram to sleep and made the covenant with Abram. I mean, it's a vivid picture there in Genesis. He made covenant so that, because he knew that Abraham couldn't keep the promise. See, that's another thing that keeps us from walking in the rest of God, is we make all these promises to God. We overpromise and underdeliver, forgetting that the only promise that affects or in any way influences your relationship with God is not the copious promises that you make to him, but the singular promise that he made to you, and that is that he would never leave or forsake you. So when Abram wakes up, it's done like it was with Adam. I hope that does not just seem mystical or ethereal. What I'm longing for is I don't want to leave this earth until I finally wake up. That I am fully conscious of the things that I'm talking about here. That I am not here with a life sentence just to endure. And now that I'm in the second half of life, I'm coming even more and more aware of how present I am to be and how much I am to enjoy this rather than enduring this. That his yoke is easy. Gosh, how many of you are tired of making it hard? His yoke is easy, and his burden is light. So, Father, this morning, your sons and daughters throughout this room are learning to yield to your yoke. They're coming to you again. Some of them need to experience what it means to be born again, again. We're so thankful, Lord, for your mercy and grace. We're so thankful for your patience. A better word, your long suffering toward us. And we believe, Lord, that throughout this room, that people that are in the grip of anxiety, people that are in the grip still of thinking that they are to perform or even that they are to please you, may they recognize that you are pleased with them just because of who they are, just because they have a pulse. That's all they need to know. When we look at our sons and daughters, we certainly are proud of their accomplishments. But Lord, that's not what it takes to please us. We are pleased just to have had the opportunity, Lord, to have had them come from you and through us into our lives. We thank you for that, Lord. We thank you for that. Amen. Amen. I know you guys have a ministry team. Yeah. Always good to see you. Always good to see you. Come on, John.
That was so good. If I could have the prayer team come on up. So good and not so easy. Saying the word that Paul said he strived to enter rest. It's not easy. And so we're going to bring our prayer team up this morning. Apparently just on my left side. It's a good side. If you're on this side, it's the prayer side. Way to hold it down. Way to hold it down. Thank you, Lord. Can we just bless and thank Randall for that message this morning? Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to actually put up the giving slide back there, and we're going to bless Randall and Lee no matter what. I think it's important, though, that we give to people as they come through and minister. I think it's important for you, actually, to honor those that minister. And so, when you use the QR code, it'll just give an option to drop down and do guest. Maybe we'll put some offering plates even on the platform and just do it that way. But this morning, if you need prayer, you can come on up. So we bless you as you go. And if you need prayer, come up here this morning about anything. They'll pray with you. They'll join with you. And otherwise, have a blessed week. And we'll see you soon.